New Zealand. Sorry if I cut that song short for you, but I've got a bit of reading to do, and after this I have a meeting that I can't be late for, so I'm just going to jump straight into it, because our first chapter, it's pretty long, so right into it. As far as the Marine commanders were concerned, the first priority after arriving in Masterton was rest and recreation for their men. They had been through hell on the Pacific and needed a well-deserved rest. The New Zealanders knew that the Marines were coming and had started preparing. Several weeks before they arrived, a notice appeared in the local newspaper. The American Red Cross Services Club will be opening in Masterton in the near future. The club is located in the building recently occupied by the furniture department of Mrs. W. E. Cody Limited, Queen Street, near the fire station. The object of this club is to provide recreational facilities and entertainment, and also food prepared and cooked in the American manner for men of the Allied Services. The opening of the club will provide the women of Masterton and the district with an admirable opportunity of showing their hospitality to visiting servicemen from overseas, and a large band of helpers is required for canteen work as well as dance hostesses and in other ways. The club will be open from 7 a.m. to 11 p.m. Several hundred helpers will be required for running the canteen. Those wishing to assist are invited to give their name and address to the club next week so that a register of all helpers can be compiled. The club director, Mrs. Tom Learmont, who is a member of staff of the American Red Cross, wishes to express her deep appreciation of the generosity of residents who have given furniture for the lounge, and states that she is pleased to be in Masterton as every assistance is being willingly given to her in her work here. She points out that New Zealand soldiers in uniform will be welcomed in the club. The Marines arrived a fortnight later, and after settling into their new camp, they were given the opportunity to take leave around the country. They leapt at the chance and travelled far and wide throughout New Zealand. Many of the Marines that arrived in Masterton were stricken with malaria, other illnesses, or recovering from wounds. Some had malaria flare-ups, which required stays in hospital facilities. But for the more serious cases, the men were sent to the hospital at Silverstream in Upper Hutt, on the other side of the Remutaka Range. Construction of Silverstream Hospital began in late 1941. The site was planned to be used for New Zealanders, but with the arrival of so many United States personnel, many who were recovering from malaria, the site was repurposed. At any given time, it could accommodate 1,600 patients. In all, 20,000 spent time here during the war, including Don Adams, who later became famous for portraying Maxwell Smart in the television sitcom Get Smart. The hospital was also visited during the war by First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt. For the more minor cases, hospitals have been set up in Solway and Memorial Camps. It was also said that a sick bay was set up in a converted residence in a downtown Masterton home. There were not many instances of Marines getting injured while camped in Wairarapa, but a couple of incidents did make the newspapers. On June 24, 1943, as a result of a car overturning while negotiating a turn from the Māori Pā at Te Oriori to the main road, Privates James Wurgels and Herbert Sullivan, USMC, were admitted to the Masterton Hospital last night. Wurgels suffered a broken collarbone, spinal injuries, and slight head injuries, and Sullivan from shock. After receiving treatment, Sullivan was discharged from hospital today. Two other Marines who were in the car were not injured. On August 5, 1943, Technical Sergeant Kress of the United States Marine Corps was admitted to the Masterton Hospital at 7:50 o'clock last night with leg injuries and abrasions. The hospital ambulance was called to Waingawa, where it is stated Kress was knocked down by a passing car while he was walking on the main road. And most tragic of all, August 2, 1943, Private First Class Eugene Sutton of the United States Marine Corps died in the Masterton Hospital yesterday morning from a gunshot wound received on the previous night. It is understood that Sutton was on guard duty and the wound was received accidentally. The matter will be investigated by American authorities. 2 weeks of leave were granted to the Marines before they had to be back in camp. Many took this opportunity to see more of the country, and they really liked what they saw. George Baird stayed local and had a look around Wellington and the Wairarapa area. The harbour at Wellington is surrounded by very high hills, and you can ride up into those hills and look out over the harbour, and it's a very pretty kind of circular view and great to look at. The mountains between there and Masterton, I suppose, are probably just really high hills, but are very scenic. This little train goes chugging up the way, and when it gets to the top, or at least on the trip I was on once, they stop and pull over at a siding and you can have a light tea or lunch. When you get back on the train and go down the other side of the mountain, of course there are a lot of sheep and a lot of pretty grass and little lakes. It is an extremely nice country. Frederick Selig headed 139 miles north and explored Napier. I didn't know anything about the country, but I heard Napier up north along the coast was a resort town. I bought a train ticket, packed a bag, and I took off. I had no problem getting a very nice hotel and reserved a room for a week. I did a lot of walking around and met up with another Marine, whom I did not know, but he was from our battalion. We walked around together and met a couple of New Zealand Army WACs, Women's Army Corps. We dated them. We went to a movie and walked around, and when the conversation ran out, we were told the ladies were engaged. With the rest of his Marine mates going north, Wayne Harter thought that he would head south, 328 miles to Christchurch, which involved a ferry trip across Cook Strait. Everyone seemed to be going north, to Rotorua, Taupo, all throughout the area, and I thought to get away from the hustle and bustle, I'll go to Christchurch. While I was down in Christchurch, I went to a vicarage. I was invited to a vicarage and went out for tea, or dinner or something. I went back a second time and chatting to this chap, and I got him to write to my parents telling them that he'd met me and I was fine, and I was fit and well and all sorts, and of course that came out in the local rag, and Mum kept it actually. The American Red Cross Services Club in Masterton became a popular place for young Marines to socialise. The cooks had gone out of their way to provide cuisine that was familiar to the Americans. The menu would have looked rather strange to a New Zealand soldier who came in for a meal, but delectable to a hungry Marine. A Masterton woman who was there at the time remembers the unusual food that the Marines were keen on and did not find it at all appetizing. I can still remember what they used to eat. They used to eat these pancake things. Then they'd put a whole lot of golden syrup on top and then eggs on top of that and bacon. Yuck. In the first week of April, 4,658 Americans and 1,015 New Zealand servicemen enjoyed a meal at the Red Cross Club. Since the club opened, it had served between 4,000 and 6,000 meals to servicemen a week. The club was staffed between 500 and 800 volunteers each week, and the dances held there were very popular, so much so that girls would come up from Carterton. The dances were held every Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday and Saturday nights, with music supplied by the Marine Band. The Masterton Borough Council had loaned a piano to the club when it had opened, along with 140 collapsible chairs. While the club was open to American and New Zealand servicemen, it was not open to the Home Guard, on the basis there were limited supplies available due to rationing, and the club was meant for servicemen who were away from home. The Home Guard worked regular jobs when not on duty and lived locally, so were not eligible. The Home Guard headquarters went so far as to state that the Red Cross Club had been placed out of bounds for their members. During this time, the conduct of the Marines was praised. Marine Mayor Jordan stated that he appreciated the high conduct of the Marines that were quartered here and that the local police had reported no issues with them. At the end of April, the hours of operation of the club were changed from the initial 7 a.m. to 11 p.m. The facility would now open at 3 p.m. daily, except on Sundays when it opened at lunchtime. Dances were also not to take place on Saturday nights anymore. Free meals would no longer be given to volunteer workers because it was felt by some that this was costing the club too much, although it was stated that tea and toast would be given and a full meal would be given to those workers who went without a break for a meal on certain shifts. The American Red Cross were very careful in how they chose volunteers for the club. They only wanted well-behaved girls and were meticulous in their selection. The sort of women in town who were leading lights, shall I say, responsible sorts of people, and they were asked by the authorities to choose so many girls each, and they would have dances and so on. In June, it was announced that three girls from the United States had arrived to help at the club. All hail from New England. Miss Ruth Nesbitt formerly lived in Newton, Massachusetts, and worked in New York as an actuary's assistant for 4 years. Miss Marcella Kelly is a Manchester, Connecticut resident and was a teacher at Hartford. Miss Alta Powell of Hamden, Connecticut, was a reporter for a year on the Hartford Courant. They will assist in the canteen and work with the recreation program on Monday, Thursday, and Saturday and Sunday nights. Dances became a regular feature of the club and were very popular and varied in their themes. On the 4th of July, Independence Day, the Red Cross Club was adorned with American flags and decorated to look like a picnic ground. The following night, festivities continued with many novelty dances, as well as potato races and musical chairs. In the second week of August, the Marines opened the club to 200 local children from the three local orphanages and to all state borders. The event was organized by Lieutenant Commander Holtz, and entertainers were brought in from Wellington specially. The afternoon's entertainment was hosted by Staff Sergeant John F. Magner, who had been in the entertainment business before the war. The Marines provided bountiful refreshments, and at the end of the program, the children all sang "For They Are Jolly Good Fellows," followed by a calling for three cheers for the American hosts, which the children gave very heartily. Members of the Wairarapa College Pipe Band were sometimes allowed in as well. The College Pipe Band would often lead the Americans as they paraded down Queen Street, and as a reward, the students were allowed into the club for some refreshments. Owen Pryor was a member of the band at the time. We had a few parades through the street and so on, and we were always able to have an adjourn, just a raspberry drink. It was fun. You only got in there in your pipe band uniform after a parade. Over the next few months, a variety of dances were held in the club. It was never a boring time with the Marines. For a week in July, the club was decorated for the theme as South of the Border, and the dancers had a Southern States feel to them. 2 weeks later, a truth or truth and consequences event was held, with questions and consequences for the Marines and their partners who gave the wrong answers. In the first week of August, they went above and beyond. The main doorway will represent a ship's gangplank, and the large recreation hall will be decorated like a tropical isle. One corner will be a typical native scene with palm trees, coconuts, a grass hut, and a moon bright under the amber spotlight. Three hula dances and many South Sea songs will be the evening's program, centered around the wedding celebration of an island princess. A hobo dance featured the hall decorated with clothes hung on wire and a campfire. Each time, the club made a real effort to make the themed dance memorable. Although it wasn't just dancing and music, the servicemen could play dominoes, cards, and pool at the club. Other activities included bingo, bridge, and a scavenger hunt. On October 1st, a backwards dance was held. Marines and their partners wore their uniforms backwards, and popular American sayings were placed on the walls, but upside down. It was a fun evening, but it would also be one of the last occasions where the locals would see their Marine friends. The rules for the dances were quite strict. Women could dance with their American partner, but they were not allowed to go outside with him. The American Red Cross had rigorous selection processes that ensured they only had girls they knew would behave themselves. It was a difficult time for New Zealand men that were still in Masterton, having to compete with the newcomers. The girls thought the Americans were lovely. Of course, their uniforms were lovely compared to the poor New Zealand battle dress. The American take on dating girls was also different. To show their affection, they would send girls they liked flowers, candy, and take them out for dinner. The New Zealand man on his slim wages struggled to compete with that. With the uniform, the accent, the American charm, it didn't take long before the girls started to swoon. With the Americans in the country, New Zealand livened up a bit. Everywhere they travelled, they brightened up the area, but not all were happy with the flashy new visitors. Some of the older citizens, particularly in the religious community, were concerned about the behaviour of their young people. A warning notice by the Auckland Presbytery coincided with the Marines being in town, suggesting it was unlikely to be a coincidence. That in view the moral laxity in city, which is causing grave concern to the authorities, the Presbytery authorize the moderator to issue a pastoral letter to congregations and their ministers be requested to preach on the need for personal purity and self-control for the better sense of responsibility on the part of the parents in the training and control of their young people. By April 1943, there had been 83 marriages involving American servicemen, including naval personnel, just in the Wellington region. A notice in the paper later that month in response to the article on the 83 marriages reflected the older community's view, containing an obvious biased tone to it, that New Zealand girls were marrying Americans. It was not such a good thing. It does not seem likely, however, that Christchurch and the rest of the South Island will be affected in the same way. So far, no marriage between a New Zealander and a United States serviceman has been recorded in Christchurch. The use of the word affected is particularly barbed, implying that it is some kind of ailment. Clearly the rioter had some anti-American sentiments, which were certainly shared by some of the New Zealand men. It became a common term amongst some here to describe the Americans as overpaid, oversexed, and over here. A crude poem credited to a soldier in the NZEF reflected this. I dedicate this poem of mine to loyal girls who toe the line and stick to our boys in khaki and blue, forever staunch, forever true. We salute the girls who stick to us through all the flattery and fuss brought from afar to our fair land by the glamorous Yankee band. With their hiya toots and howdy honey, plenty of swank and pots of money, they give you this and they buy you this, but it's only a very short moment of bliss. You may be dazzled for a while by a drawling speech and flashy smile, but we know the girls who stop to say, goodbye, Yank, be on your way. When this war is over and done, these girls who will have the fun, for by them the flippant type will be as out as the Statue of Liberty. Remember, 'twill the New Zealanders dressed in khaki and Air Force blue, who will stand beside you with joy and pride on the day when you're a happy bride. And in conclusion, let me state, this is not a hymn of hate, but a piece of sound advice if you want your wedding bells and rice. The local girls did not listen to Mr. NZEF, and the engagements in Wairarapa started in April, with the first marriage a month later. Glancing through the local newspapers during the time the Marines were based here, there were 11 marriages in Wairarapa between New Zealand girls and Marines, and a further 4 engagements. While some would suggest this reckless and rushed, the number of marriages between local girls and New Zealand servicemen for the same period was about the same. There was every possibility that once their man headed back overseas, he could be killed. So the general attitude was to enjoy the time you had while you could. At the time, resentment was simmering between 2 American battalions. The 4th were annoyed because the 3rd had a head start in meeting all the local girls. Some in the 3rd were also questioning the right of the 4th to be here, as they had seen little action when compared to the 3rd. Not all marriages and engagements worked out. A few months isn't a long time to get to know somebody, and some of the girls that married and moved to America returned to New Zealand when things didn't work out. Others realized before they went to America that things had changed. One Masterton woman remembers a friend who had such an experience. Jo was sent overseas, and she kept writing to me, and she was getting all ready to marry Jo as soon as the war was over. So then I had this pitiful letter. She had a letter from Joe's sister, I think it was, and as soon as he had been discharged from the Marines, he was walking the streets somewhere in America, I think it was near Mexico, and he met a girl and looked at her and fell in love, and he went and married. And this poor girl, she got a letter from Joe's sister to say that Joe was married to somebody else and that she had her glory box all boxed. She had her glory. Ah, it's a Monday. She had her glory box prepared to go over to America and marry him. Other marriages worked out well, with several brides heading overseas and living out the rest of their lives happily with their new husbands. Some Marines even returned after the war and settled in Macedon, marrying their wartime girlfriends. Today, there are still several descendants of the Marines living in Wairarapa. Aside from the Red Cross Club, there were other opportunities for the Marines to go out and enjoy snacks and meals. Masterton was home to a soft drink factory, a few milk bars, and the Marines flocked to them. You would see them in the milk bars, and they would be dishing out dollar notes when we saw them. It was quite common, quite a common occurrence. After years of everyone having a lack of money and the shops struggling to make a profit, the coming of the Americans was a blessing. While most shopkeepers were good about it, some couldn't help themselves and took advantage of the situation. The Marines soon cottoned on to the honest stores. They hadn't been paid for months because they'd been up in the islands, and they got their pay and some of the shops just robbed them. It was really bad. See, they had no idea of the money. They just sort of holed it out. It was a real bonanza for the shops. Many families were keen to take in some of the Marines to show their appreciation of the American support and giving them company and a good meal. Keith brought one home from town. He was leaning against a lamppost one Saturday, and he came in here. He joined the Home Guard, and of course he was training in that case. Well, he was training in case there was trouble here. And coming in from the Home Guard one evening, he saw this fellow leaning against a lamppost, and he looked so dejected and miserable. And he said, "Would you like to come home with me for tea?" And he said, "Would I what? I'd love that." Sorry, I was stumbling on the 1940s lingo there. Many of the Marines were able to have home-cooked meals, many having mutton for the first time in their lives, and commenting that this was some of the best meat they'd ever tasted. For a few lucky Marines, they were invited to billet with local families. Those that had spare rooms or a son that was overseas took the opportunity to show their appreciation for what the Marines had done by giving them a proper bed. Many stayed with the same family for the duration of their stay in Masterton, which was much more comfortable arrangement than living in a tent. The gratitude was returned with the gifting of supplies to those that had helped them. They were really good, these Americans, and they would give. We lived the life of luxury there for a while. When they were there, they would give us big tins of peaches and big tins with frozen boxes with chocolate, lollies, ice cream. They used to give, my God. The Marines were also generous, handing out treats to children of the town. For the older kids, American cigarettes were free and plentiful, but only if you asked. With the influx of US goods, it was inevitable that there would be a black market in American supplies. As they were intended for use by the United States servicemen only, there was no duty on them. Customs officers were coming across suspicious packages sent through the Postal Service and began to investigate. In one instance, they intercepted three kit bags which had come from overseas. Inside, they found a bonanza of luxury items from the time. 3 dozen white handkerchiefs, 11 pairs of woolen socks, 58 pairs of white socks, 57 boxes of 100 razor blades, 3,625 cigarettes, and 9 boxes of security rubberware. Masterton was a dry town in the sense that you could not legally purchase alcohol, but that did not mean you couldn't buy it at all. The Americans had their own beer that they brought into New Zealand. There was at least one truck shipment of American beer which was sent to Solway Camp just after the Marines arrived to help keep the peace. But there are stories from American residents at the time that suggested this was not only a one-time thing. Some locals swear you could buy a beer at the Red Cross Club, which would be interesting as that would have been illegal under the local law. And Marines did seem to enjoy a good beer or two. They got a bit pickled in the canteen. They had this American beer which was pretty strong apparently, and they would drive on the wrong side of the road. "Get out of the goddamn road, you Kiwis." We were driving on the correct side, but they would get pickled and come along in these jeeps driving on the right-hand side. Some saw the no-license law and a battalion of Marines eager for a drink as a great business opportunity. Under the law, the Marines would have to travel out of the Masterton district to buy a drink. But if someone was to set up a small business that hadn't happened to travel by the camp, that would be rather convenient. Sly grogging became a lucrative but risky business, with some serious profit to be made. In a case where two sly groggers were caught selling to Marines in Masterton, the prices of their wares was revealed. A bottle of wine would set you back £1, and a bottle of cider 12 shillings and sixpence. To put that into context, a dozen 26-ounce bottles of beer could be bought for £1 from a legal retail brewery. The local police senior sergeant said sly grogging was going on an extensive scale. Two sly groggers caught were convicted. One was fined £20, and the ringleader a whopping £100, the equivalent of $5,875. Marine George Beard remembers one of the rogues. The bootlegger set himself up right outside the fence to the fairgrounds, so all we had to do was climb over the fence to get there. I had my one and only drink of scotch that I'd ever had in my life there. The two guys I was with bought this bottle of scotch, and I had a drink, of course, since that was the thing to do. There was one incident which would have resulted in some Marines getting a serious rollicking by their officers. On March 22, 1943, there were complaints of noise and disturbances at a house at the Māori pā at Te Oriori in Masterton. When the police arrived, they found a number of Māori and Marines drinking and fighting and a half-empty barrel of beer. Inquiries were made, and the supplier of the beer was fined. It was not clarified what punishments were meted out to the partygoers, but unfortunately for those there, the police confiscated the remaining beer. New Zealand was known for its hunting and fishing, and Marines were eager for an opportunity to do both. Wayne Harter especially was very eager to do some trout fishing. I was a very, very keen fisherman. When I was a kid, of course, I'd taken out one... No, I'm going to read that again. I was a very, very keen fisherman when I was a kid, and of course I was taken out to one of the really good streams here by an old friend that I had met and caught plenty of trout. And I mentioned to him at the time, I said, boy, I'm coming back here because what you got, fishing and hunting, I said, that'll do me. Around Masterton, the best place to fish was the Ruamahanga River. This river starts in the Tararua Range and runs all the way to Lake Wairarapa and into the sea at Palliser Bay. Masterton was one of the early sites in New Zealand to have a trout hatchery, which started in the 1880s. From here, trout were distributed into the Wairarapa rivers and throughout the country. Harter later settled in Masterton after meeting his future wife while he was camped here and became an instructor on freshwater fly fishing. Many Wairarapa residents who now enjoy fishing in local rivers owe their initial knowledge and introduction to fly fishing to this former marine. For saltwater fishing, the experience at Castle Point on the coast was unmissable. Fishing off the top of the reef at that time could result in some spectacular fish, many weighing over 30 pounds. Locals would happily take the Marines to their fishing spots in return for a trip out to the coast. New Zealanders knew the best fishing spots and had the gear. The Marines had the transport and the gas. It was the perfect union. Hunting was also a great pastime for Americans, and they were very enthusiastic, sometimes a little too enthusiastic. We would have a whole string of Marines coming out in their jeeps, and they would have machine guns and all the automatic rifles. And they said, there are rabbits out there, we understand. I really had to hold them back from shooting a sheep. They wanted to shoot everything that moved. They had the grog with them too. They had all sorts of things. And we would go out to the back of the Kaituna. The hills were ridden with rabbits. You would put a shot out and you would see the whole hillside move in different directions. That's not quite right. You would see the whole hillside move in all different colours. The rabbits were terrible, they were. And they would have a marvellous time out there. A marine group from the 2nd Tank Battalion that was stationed at Otaki on the other side of the Tararua Range also engaged in a bit of hunting in the area. A very hectic 5 days. All men had ample supply of food, cigarettes, etc. When word leaked out that we were coming, the deer left the country. A few goats were bagged. Warning to all amateurs, stay very close to the trail or you'll be sorry. Take from one who knows. This is a very long chapter. 3 more pages. There were other things to do. There were other things the Marines could do around Wairarapa for entertainment and recreation. For those that wanted to attend religious services, there were several churches in town. They were remembered by patrons of the Methodist Church for being immaculately dressed, very well behaved, and that they sang beautifully. The Marines also took part in local theatre. An American play, Arsenic and Old Lace, was being performed in the Masterton Little Theatre Society. And locals were delighted when most of the male parts were read by guest readers from the United States Marine Corps, giving a real Brooklyn atmosphere to the presentation. Masterton Catholic priest Nicholas Moore would give the Marines rides in his little Austin car. He didn't have much gas, but did all he could to make the Americans welcome and take them where they wanted to go. The United States Marine Corps Band also gave performances to the people of the town. On August 8, 1943, the Marine Band set up in the Masterton Park and gave a show for the people, who turned up in large numbers to hear them play. The performance given by the band was most credible, especially in view of the fact that the men practiced in their off-duty hours. The program given by the band catered for all tastes and ranged from popular modern dance music, stirring marches, to more serious music. Mayor Jordan thanked them for their efforts and said he was looking forward to more performances by the band. The local picture theatre, The Regent, just across the road from the Red Cross Club on Queen Street, also had programmes that were set aside for the Marines and their partners to attend. While the Marines were in Masterton, the Star Spangled Banner would play at the Regent before showing in honour of the Marines. This caused some contention, as it was played before the American... This caused some contention as it was played before the New Zealand anthem, and some locals were not too happy about the arrangement. There was also opportunities for the Marines to partake in sports. The YMCA was a popular venue, and the Americans were given the chance to play basketball, something that they jumped at. Marines from Masterton and other parts of New Zealand took place in matches against them and against the New Zealand teams. The Marines were kept in check by the United States Military Police, who would patrol along Queen Street making sure that all their young men were behaving themselves. They had a strong presence in the Red Cross Club and had a reputation for being quite fierce. You would not want to be misbehaving when one of them was around. Overall, there was little in the way of complaints about the behaviour of the Marines while they were out for a bit of fun in town. Local stories tell of a number of houses of ill repute, supposedly somewhere down Reynolds Street, but the details of where they were and who visited them have not been recorded, and those who are in the know aren't telling. That part of the Marine tale in Wairarapa is to remain a secret. Finally finished that chapter. I've got one heck of a dry throat right now, but the next chapter is much shorter. So we're going to play you a piece of music now. I'm going to rest my voice, get it back, and then we'll come back and do that one for you. This is a wartime piece of music. Many will know it. It actually has a Te Reo version as well, which is excellent, but this is the original one. I think it came out in 1939. Flanagan and Allen doing Run, Rabbit, Run.
On the farm, every Friday on the farm is rabbit pie day. So every Friday that ever comes along, I get up early and sing this little song. Run, rabbit, run, run, run. Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Bang, 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 bang goes the farmer's gun. Run, rabbit, run, 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 run. Run, rabbit, run, run, run. Don't give the farmer his fun, fun, fun. He'll get by without his rabbit pie. So run, rabbit, run, run, run. Run, rabbit, run. Bang, 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 bang goes the farmer's gun. Run, rabbit, run. Don't give the farmer his fun. He'll get by without his rabbit pie. So run, rabbit, run.
And that was Run, Rabbit, Run. I realise why my voice might be a little bit sore. I've talked for about 31 minutes straight, so must be a new record for me. So this chapter is not as long, which is good for me in a way. So this is chapter 6. We're up to training montage. Contrary to popular belief, the Marines were not just here for rest and recreation. After a period of leave to allow for rest and recreation, it was time to start getting serious again, building up fitness and retraining for a return to the war against Japan in the Pacific. After a few weeks, the regime of physical training began, starting as soon as the Marines woke up. By the time the training began, Wairarapa was heading into winter. It was starting to get quite cold. First thing in the morning when we got up, we'd fill the old stove full of wood and coal and so on, toss on a heap of kerosene and throw a match in it. There'd be a horrible explosion and the ring of explosions from all over the camp. And then we would go out for a run. And by the time we got back, of course, the fire would be roaring nice and warm. Long marches out into the outskirts would also be part of the training. And locals remember seeing them out in columns and helped them where they could. The soldiers did route marches out to Bennett's Hillway. When they were returning to camp, they came down Colombo Road. And when they reached our place, the officers would halt the troop and stand them down. Mum supplied them with water, and they would raid our large orchard of fruit that was ready. We had a large experimental orchard, all sorts of fruits and nuts. Aside from marching and physical trainings, the Marine also did manoeuvres close to town, something not missed by the locals. I was washing up and looked out, and there were these three men creeping along the back of our house. They were doing manoeuvres, you see. Route marches became common, and it was necessary to get the Marines fit so they would be able to handle being back on the islands again. While marching around Masterton was quite pleasant, things became much more difficult when they headed east into the Tararua Range for jungle warfare training. The conditions that best matched the Pacific were in the Tararua Mountains and the areas below, with thick bush, plentiful rivers and streams. It would not just be the Masterton-based Marines that would train in this area. The New Zealand forces had trained here as well, including the aptly titled Misery Farm, named because the conditions there were so bad. Although the Marines did not train on this site, they did experience their fair share of misery. They camped up by the Waingawa River at one stage and were shelling and doing all sorts of things up there. I'm going to read that again, I did it way too slowly. They camped up by the Waingawa River at one stage and were shelling and doing all sorts of things up there, practicing. But also when they went up there, they were not used to our swift rising rivers, and they put all their tents down on the stones beside the river, and the Waingawa removed them during the night. They were Marines, not from Solway, they were from Wellington. Local men that were familiar with the Tararua Range were employed to help with the jungle warfare training. Well-known New Zealand mountaineer and photographer John Pascoe was one of those instructors. Early next morning, we moved down the valley through thick bush and made base camp at the TT branch of the Whakatike. We had a time for a scout to scout around and get a lay of the watershed. The next day we had instruction from various angles, and this varied with a round trip along some tops, and we were divided into small parties and returned to base on different set courses. Oil bath army compasses made this easy work. After a preliminary skirmish the next day with regular troops, we retired wiser, but on the following morning we took up ambush positions to battle with these regulars who were expected from the big American camp at Pai Kakariki. Our job was to act as scouts and then as nuisances. We had to report activity in detail and lay traps. G.B. Wilson and I put our signaller with a radio up a tall tree, and we hid in open country to observe the enemy. Wilson slid ahead of them, and while I took their photographs as they passed me, I did not know I was there. They did not know that I was there, or that I had shot them with my camera. I followed along their tail, but found that the signaller had been spotted and made to send bogus messages back to our headquarters. So I leapt up the hill and made fast time to bypass the enemy and report the doings to our officers. There were many highlights of the mock battle, not the least how Southey snared an enemy officer with a noose across his leg. With a noose across a log. A feature of these antics was that some of the men had imitation hand grenades called thunder flashes, which were thrown at regulars to explode with a lot of noise but no shrapnel. Training in the Tararua range was tough. Conditions there can change quickly and become very cold and wet. Many Marines had to spend uncomfortable nights with no shelter after losing their way in the dark. They were forced to hike through the bush at night. It was easy to miss the tracks and get lost. Reinforcing while local guides was so important. Other times they were told they could not take tents, and they had to get through the night without shelter. When the weather changed abruptly, this became very uncomfortable. There was a good deal of shivering and wetness. It was quite a sight at dawn to see various groups struggling with their smoky twigs to get some porridge warmed up in Army Dixies. These trips were designed that way and were called toughening up trips. Training in the range was indeed tough. Sometimes Marines would write entries in the mountain hut logbooks, and some extracts illustrate the kind of activity that the Marines were doing and just how easily they could lose their way. April 18, 1943. The 2nd Scout Company, 2nd Marine Division, United States Marine Corps, arrived here from Toheraniko Hut at the state. Left 0700 hours, arrived Alpha Hut 2030 hours. Leave tomorrow for Field Hut at Ōtaki Forks. Believed to be the first military organization to make the Southern Crossing. J.H. Nelson, Captain, United States Marine Corps. April 24th, 1943. Searching party for Captain Nelson and party. Arrived at Alpha Hut 2 p.m. Sunday, leaving Monday a.m. for Kaitoke Station. Corporal M.P. Pinkham. April 26, 1943. Here's the story. The scout company got in okay, but Captain Nelson and his party of two, which stayed to look for the stragglers, didn't get in. So Corporal Pinkham, Private Schleins, and myself came back up here to look for them. No signs. Returning Kaitoke now. Staff Sergeant Ed Driscoll, Jr., United States Marine Corps. There are no other reports of Nelson and his two party members being missing in the Tararua Range, so it is assumed they would have eventually hiked or been found by search parties. Not all were so fortunate. An aircraft of the Royal New Zealand Air Force with two members went down in the Tararua Range in November of 1941. It was not found until April of 1943. The defence battalions were equipped with new anti-aircraft guns and rangefinders, and trained with them in the Masterton area. Both guns, rangefinders and spotlights, all of which were guarded at all times. We had 14 new 40mm guns with 14 new M5 directors and 14 four-cylinder gasoline-powered AC generators. The guns and generators were fairly simple to be trained on, and maintenance was fairly routine. The directors were another type of equipment. They were precision electromechanical devices which completely controlled the aiming of the guns. The guns and the spotlights were a curiosity to the locals, who ventured as close as they could to see them. We used to go down to the end of Sussex Street, Joyce and I particularly, and there were anti-aircraft guns that were set up at the back end of the gardens, at the back of Cliff's small holding there. And we would watch the aircraft guns swivelling around, anti-aircraft guns, and the kitty hawks and things swooping in, just at practically gun barrel level, and swooping over. And we thought it was terribly exciting. We were not very conscious of the fact that the Japanese were not very far away at that stage, you know. These training exercises were for tracking only. While live ammunition was stored at the camps, it was not fired in the town area. Several rounds of decayed 30-06 ammunition was found at Solway during investigations before the site was developed, but none had been fired. All were harmless as the acidity in the soil had dissolved the walls of the casings and the cordite within. The Marines would also get the chance to fire their bigger guns. It would not be at a poor stag. At the beginning of September, with the departure from New Zealand looming, the Marines of the 3rd Defence Battalion made their way to Riversdale Beach, 34 miles away by road. Notices appeared in the newspapers warning the public to keep clear of the area for their own safety. Danger area originating above coordinates 15.95 to 23.75 from 37 degrees clockwise to 157 degrees true azimuths. Danger limit 25,000 yards to sea and 40,000 feet in altitude. Also night firing Wednesday, September 1st between the hours of 7 and 12 p.m. Marine Frederick Selig mentions going out to Riversdale in his memoirs. We finally set out on one of the East Coast beaches for practice firing. We again were in pyramidal tents for a couple of weeks. And we were firing. No, we weren't. That doesn't sound right. We were again in pyramidal tents for a couple of weeks at the firing range. The first morning after the guns were set up on their outriggers, one of the guns was moving in an erratic way. The barrel was going up and down in jerky motions. Captain Nelson was over by one of the portable generators used to power the guns of the directors. He called me over and said, I think that gun has a bad oil gear. I said, I think it's the synchro motor in the director, Captain. Go check it out, he ordered. I went to our spare parts chest and pulled out a new synchro motor and installed it on the elevation side of the director. The gun was operating normally in about 10 minutes. I reported back to the captain and showed him the bad motor. He looked at me with a smile and said, okay, you were right. After our last time firing at the beach, we packed up and returned to our tents and sheep sheds. The Marines travelled to training areas that were beyond walking distance in their own transport, which dominated the roads. While in Wairarapa, they had the opportunity to hone their driving skills, particularly on some windy country roads. Driving out to the coast for exercises or a bit of fishing, the four-wheel drive vehicles would prove their worth. Some of the locals were not too pleased with the increase in military vehicles on the road. In a letter to the Wairarapa Times Age, the author, motorist, aired their opinions. During Wednesday and Thursday last, traffic conditions were appalling, and it was only by the exercise of extreme care by motorists that accidents did not occur. The use of Queen Stream by military lorries and tanks of all types for through traffic and parking purposes is one that should receive immediate attention by the authorities concerned. But having so many military vehicles fully fueled on the streets could also be of great benefit to the locals. Oh, sorry, my voice is starting to dry out. Not much longer to go, though. We used to have the Americans going past in lorries, etc., and I can remember one lorry ran up the road and burst its benzene tank. All the Americans yelled, bring out some containers. So, of course, gas was scarce, and we took tins, and we had a lovely lot of petrol. I'll never forget that. Yeah, that is it. Excellent. So that was that one. We've got, I think, three chapters left, and then we're actually done, and then we'll go back to a regular one. But that's just quite fun doing this. Yeah, I'm way over time as well. It's amazing how much it takes to actually do an audiobook. So I will catch up with you on Monday again. We'll do another couple of chapters. They're getting smaller now. That was some seriously long chapters in that one. So the next few are shorter. Maybe we can play some more music. Maybe I'll bring a bottle of water and sneak off and have a drink in between as well. So yeah, have a brilliant week. Stay warm. We will catch up with you next week.